episode 83 of the Hipsters podcast. My name is Chris, and we're doing something a little bit different this week. I talked to two fans who attended shows on the most recent tour to get some more first-hand accounts of what transpired. First, I talked to Travis about the Upper Darby, Pennsylvania show and fan meetup, and then I talked to Matt about the Milwaukee show. So let's get to it. Travis, welcome to the Hipsters United podcast.
Thanks a lot. Great to be here.
So which show did you attend on the most recent tour that just ended?
Tower Theater in Philadelphia, Upper Darby, Pennsylvania.
And that was the final show of the tour, right?
Yeah.
And did you attend the meetup beforehand?
Yes, sir.
And how was that? So I heard at some of the later meetups, we talked on a previous podcast to some people that went to the first couple of meetups, and those, it was just Kerry Brown, and the fans kind of ran it with Kerry acting as the co-captain, I guess. But I heard that some of the later ones, the band showed up. Did the band come to the one in Philly?
Yeah, we definitely got one of the good meetups. Kerry introduced, you know, himself at the beginning and said that, you know, we have a special guest. Normally they don't do this. And then Gio came upstairs and said, all right, here's the deal. You know, Billy's coming upstairs. You know, if you rush him, I will break every bone in your body.
And he's a pretty big guy.
Yeah, he is. So Billy sat down and talked about probably 40 minutes. So it was a good long discussion, had some good questions going on. And then about 20 minutes after he sat down, Nicole and Mikey came up.
So how many fans were actually there?
There was probably about 25. Not a lot, so
that's pretty cool.
It made for a good group.
Yeah, and what kinds of questions did people ask about?
Some of the questions were, was there any like hidden gems, like when he's going through all the recordings and for all the remasters? And something that I found very interesting was, he said the last recording for Melancholy, when they were doing Airplane Flies High box set, is a full band version of Heaven Tonight by Cheap Trick. And he's trying to, you know, add strings when he has time, and he really wants to produce that song for, you know, whenever Melancholy gets re-released. So he wants to do it right and not rush it. So it sounds like that he's holding on to that song until, you know, something special to release it to the fans. So That's pretty cool.
Yeah,
usually I'm not surprised by anything he says, but that was a surprise to me.
What else? Did anybody else ask anything? Did anybody ask anything that got a bad reaction from Billy or anything?
No, we had all talked before. You know, here's the things you don't want to say.
Yeah.
You know, Metro DVD, that just don't even say it.
And, I don't know. I think he's kind of mellowed about that. He just kind of expects people are going to ask that at this point.
Yeah. He talked about the EMI, and they really didn't care if there was any bonus content on the DVDs, or they just wanted to sell Gish and Siamese Dream again. They didn't care about the extra song. So that was all Billy adding that. So that was interesting. And the DVD part almost didn't happen, but Billy had a friend that had the Gish footage, showed it to him. It was excellent condition. So that was a very last minute thing that got added on to the CDs.
At some of the other pre-show meetups, they played some songs. Did you get to hear any of the songs that are going to be re-released with Gish or Siamese Dream?
No, Kerry didn't play any songs because Light FM was doing their sound check downstairs.
Okay.
And it was way too loud. Billy was almost having to scream at everybody. But we're used to that.
Did anybody try and get any pictures or anything like that? Did they have to lay down ground rules about what you could and couldn't ask for or anything like that? Anybody try and get their stuff signed?
Yeah, Gio said no smooching and no photos with Billy. But once he left, Nicole and Mikey were really cool about taking photos, and I mean, she signed somebody's bass guitar, and he signing drumsticks, and it was really cool to see him do that. And they stayed around, you know, a long time just to chat, which was
I
nice.
Would not have thought to bring my bass guitar to a Smashing Pumpkins community meetup.
At least it didn't have, like, rat decals on it, so that was that was good.
Yeah.
And Mikey said next year's schedule is pretty booked from January to December, so he didn't go into detail, but he did say they were looking at a very packed schedule for next year. For anybody interested in the Pumpkins' future, they're going to be busy. So,
did he sound like there was going to be touring that entire time, or are they going to be going back into the studio at all?
Yeah, he sounded like they would be touring most of the year. So that was a good that's something good to hear.
Yeah. Especially for those of us who did not get to see the band on this most recent U.S. tour. I am hoping that they come near Columbus next year, since they have been here a number of times in the past.
Yeah, absolutely. My question was, how did Butch Vig get involved, and is this something that's going to progress during the reissues? Are you going to be pulling stuff from Flood and having him come in? And he said that he had asked Carrie to get in touch with Butch, and you know, I think it's La Dolly Vita and one other song he helped out with, but he remixed those songs in about 2 weeks, and you know, he really enjoyed, you know, helping out for the cause.
Hmm. Did he give any sense of what other stuff is out there as far as Gish and Siamese Dream goes? Is there going to be any more SPRC material in that vein, or did he not really touch on that?
He didn't really touch on that.
I guess it is too late now. Maybe if they do the same thing over in Europe, someone can ask him about that. Although, yeah. I'm not sure if they're going to. They haven't really said anything about doing that kind of thing. I know that when they first kind of announced it, everyone was pretty skeptical about how these things would go, but it sounds like they've all gone pretty well. And I mean, if the band started showing up by the end, it seems like, you know, from their perspective, it went pretty well too.
Yeah, I was super stoked about how, you know, how engaged he was with everybody, and everybody asked really, you know, intelligent questions. There was nothing out of line.
It seems like that's really what he's looking for in terms of fan interaction. In the past, he's talked about, you know, doing, like, you know, if you pay a little extra, you could have dinner with the band or something like that. He really seems like that he's interested in, like, kind of the small, close-knit conversations with fans rather than just a whole bunch of people online yelling stuff at him, when are you coming to Brazil, and things like that.
Yeah, one thing he did get heated about is somebody asked if they would do, like, a record release party, kind of like in the Machina era. And he was like, you know, absolutely not. He'll never trust fans with recorded material again. I think there was 5 songs on those promos that he gave out for the record release parties. I think that was 2000, maybe January 2000. And, you know, automatically, you know, if you get something from the Pumpkins, you know, 50% of the people are going to put it online.
Right.
And he said it cost him a number one spot, and, you know, pretty much cost him the good standing, you know, what little good standing they had with Virgin Records.
Oh,
and
wow.
That was pretty much the end of, you know, the Pumpkins as we know it, was when they lost that number one spot. So that was interesting.
Hmm. Well, I assume, as far as the show goes, I assume you knew in advance what songs were being played on the tour. You didn't try and avoid all news outlets.
No,
so that it would be fresh to you.
We knew exactly what was going to go on. But I brought 3 people who had, you know, one of them had seen the Pumpkins one time in Charlotte, and 2 had never seen the Pumpkins at all, and they were completely blown away about, you know, the spectacle and how tight they are together. You know, I've seen every incarnation of the band, even with, you know, Kenny Aronoff as drummer, and this was definitely the tightest show I've ever seen this version do, this SP3 or whatever you want to call it. Very good. From start to finish. It started off with the, you know, Panopticon and Quasar, and I was like, man, he's gonna lose the crowd pretty quick. But once they go into Starla, you know, that was it just went up from there. So very good. Oceania was a standout for me, and Pale Horse. It was kind of like hearing Tonight for the first time when you hear Oceania live. It was just incredible.
What did the casual fans that you were with think of the new songs? Were they kind of bored by the new material that they weren't unfamiliar with, or did they think they were good also?
No, I got really good reactions from them, especially on Oceania. You know, I got the SPRC USB, so we listened to it on the drive back the next day, and that was one of the songs. It's like, hey, can you play that one over? Can you play that one over? And both those were Pale Horse and Oceania, so... And Obscured was great to hear that live.
Yeah, that was actually so I've heard some of the earlier shows, obviously, that have been put out there on the Live Music Archive. And Obscured, I was really surprised with how well they pulled that off in an electric setting.
Yeah.
Just, I mean, the way Billy sang it just seemed really like he was really into it. Sometimes when they play kind of the more obscure older songs, you can, like when they played Bodies, for instance, during the 20th anniversary tour, it didn't really sound like Billy was into it that much. I didn't see a show where he played it. At the show that I went to, they didn't play Bodies, but
yeah,
it didn't really sound like he was really into it. But I mean, hearing Obscured, it really sounded like he was totally into it for all the older songs. So I think that's part of what made it work.
Yeah, and the Through the Eyes of Ruby with the IM1Ts at the end. I mean, it was very melancholy-ish era. Like, I saw him in, I think, 95 at Chapel Hill, and the energy of that show was very close to the energy of this show. I mean, it was, you know, just like you're playing everything super fast. No banter at all through the first 19 songs, just 19 songs straight, and then you know, he said, thanks to the Smashing Pumpkins fans, we got the greatest fans in the world, and then went right into Pissant. I mean, it was nice not to hear him go on about something.
It's funny, though. It sounds like every show this tour that he's pretty much said nothing except for at the Chicago show where he kind of joked about Catherine coming out. But besides that, it sounds like it was just music, music, music the entire time. Which is kind of odd for Billy. I mean, he's never been one to sit there and tell long stories or anything, but he'll usually stop and make a joke or two. And I guess he's finally just figures it doesn't really work. And it really doesn't, because when you're actually there in the venue, a lot of times you can't really understand what he's saying. And, you know, people just go, woo, no matter what he says. So trying to, sit there and tell a witty story doesn't really come across that well.
Yeah, he didn't really give any chance for a woo. With the interludes in between the songs, there's 15 or 20 seconds of, background music they're playing over the PA or somehow. And, that was really cool to hear. I haven't heard anything like that since Melancholy when they were doing the Planet of the Apes.
Yeah.
So that added a lot to the show. It was great.
Overall, how was the crowd there? Like, what was the age of the crowd? So we've heard at some of the past tours, Billy's made comments about the crowd seeming younger. Did the crowd seem young to you or old, or what did it
seem? It was definitely younger. I think the last time I saw him in a small venue was the Fillmore at Charlotte, and it was kind of 35-ish. Hey, you know, I bought Melancholy and Siamese Dream. I have no idea what they've done in the last 10 years. I'm going to come see the band. This seemed like, hey, I've downloaded Tear Garden, and I know Song for a Son and Awada and stuff like that. So it was like there were some kids with their dads and stuff. That was pretty cool. I mean, I drug my mom to the Adore tour. I was like, yeah, it's going to be all acoustic, you know, but it wasn't.
No. It was kind of. It was in a theater, at least in Atlanta. It was a classy affair.
Yeah, when Bullet started playing, she was like, okay, I'm going to go now.
Well, anything else about the show you wanted to talk about?
No, that was pretty much it. I never heard Bullet with Butterfly Wings start off with The World is a Vampire. It's always had the intro, you know, and him singing to the background music, The World is a Vampire.
Yeah.
But I'd never heard him do it like the album version. I don't know if it was a mistake or something, but he stops playing the guitar, mic stops, and then he walks up to the mic and says, "The World is a Vampire." So that was almost like the Double Door show. That's the last time I'd heard that. So that was cool.
Well, thanks a lot for coming on the podcast this week.
All right, you're welcome. Thanks a lot for having me, Chris.
Matt, welcome to the Hipsters United podcast.
Thank you, Chris.
So which show did you attend on the most recent tour?
Honestly, I thought it was – I only attended the Milwaukee show, but I've probably seen Corgan and Company 10 to 15 times, and I honestly thought it was probably the tightest and most cohesive set that I've probably ever witnessed of them. I think that what really caught me off guard was the fact that they literally went from one song into the other, and there was no – you know, there's – you go to a typical show and there's ebbs and flows, highs and lows. I mean, this was just kept building and building and building. It was almost like by the encore, you needed that break to catch your breath.
And no banter at all.
No, absolutely not. And I think Corgan's kind of learned his lesson from the anniversary shows. I necessarily don't mind it. I'm always entertained by stuff that, you know, comes off the top of his head. But I really couldn't complain about that at all. I mean, they played for 2 hours and 20 minutes, and you know, I thought it was a rocking, kick-ass show. I liked the new Oceania stuff. They had some great deep cuts. I've never heard Geek USA or someone played live before, or Silverfuck. So I mean, I thought it was a great show. And from what he said, it sounds like he really appreciated the fan response to the tour.
So you said you've seen them around 15 times. What eras does that span? When did you start becoming a fan?
Probably my late high school years. So when Melancholy came out, I mean, my first exposure to them was I was in the BMG Music Club, and pretty much like every teenager in the early 90s, mid-90s was. And I was big into the grunge scene. I mean, I liked Pearl Jam, Soundgarden. I liked Stone Temple Pilots. And just paging through BMG, it said, oh, Smashing Pumpkins, you like them if you like, you know, these bands. And so I bought Siamese Dream, the cassette, and I put it in. And it was something that it was definitely not something I was expecting, if you were comparing the Pumpkins to Pearl Jam and a lot of the other grunge bands. And so I was kind of like, okay, I can dig it. And then I think when Melancholy came out, that's when I really, you know, was hooked. And I got the Aeroplane Flies High box set. And I didn't actually see them until the Adore tour for the first time. And I remember being disappointed at the time because I had never seen them live before. And so I wanted to hear, you know, Siamese Dream, Melancholy, and all that stuff. And then, you know, now looking back, and I've been a solid fan for probably 15 years now, I would absolutely have loved to hear them, you know, to see them play that Adore set back in 1998. Now, I think I would have had a much greater appreciation for that tour in general. And so I was not at the Metro show, but I was at the United Center show 3 days before that. I saw them on the Machina tour. I saw Zwan probably 5 times. Big fan of Zwan. I was at the Chicago shows at the Metro, that one night show. And then I saw them on the Future Embrace tour. And then I saw them in 2008 at the Auditorium Theater in Chicago. And then I saw them on this last tour. So I don't know, maybe it wasn't exactly 10 to 15 times, but it feels like it.
So in 2008, was that the 20th anniversary tour?
Yeah. Yeah, because ever since the Reformation, they've kind of really bypassed Milwaukee, Chicago. I mean, they've only played... They didn't play, I don't think, Chicago even in 2007 when the band came up. I think the first time they played Chicago after the Reformation was for the 20th anniversary tour.
Right, they played Hammond, Indiana right before that.
Yeah.
I was at that show.
Okay. Yeah, and then this was the first time they played Milwaukee since he was in Zwan.
So which I was, is kind of unusual, since in the early days of the Pumpkins, if you go back and look at like the SPFC tour history, it seems like they were constantly rotating between Chicago and Milwaukee.
Absolutely.
In that area.
Absolutely, and at the show 2 weeks ago, was it 2 weeks ago already? Yeah, almost 2 weeks ago. I mean, he referenced the Frogs and how they're the best band in the world and how they've been playing Milwaukee since 88, and it's like, well, why haven't you played them played it here in 10 years? So hopefully there's more to come, though.
So tell me about the crowd. Was it a young crowd, old crowd? Were they into new stuff?
I was kind of taken aback because, I mean, I hadn't seen the band, you know, obviously since 2000. And then it was a very different crowd from the Zwan crowds in the solo shows that he had. I felt, I'm 32 years old, and I felt I was one of the younger, on the younger side. There were definitely a lot of, you know, I would say, 40s, mid-30s, but then I did also see some younger kids too, so it was a pretty good variety from an age standpoint, I thought.
And did they get into the new stuff, or were they more into the old Geek USA, that type of song?
I mean, yeah, the biggest reaction came from Muzzle, Soma, Silverfuck. But honestly, I think there was a pretty decent reception after Oceania was done. And looking back at the bootleg, listening to the shows, the tape, I am a huge fan of Oceania, and actually I'm a huge fan of all the new Oceania material they played on this tour. And I'm kind of disappointed now that I've seen the YouTube videos of Pinwheels. I mean, that might be my favorite Oceania song of the five or six that they played.
Yeah, that's one of my favorites also, but it seems like they didn't play that one as much.
They played it like two or three times. That's it.
Yeah.
And I know they played, I think they played Suffer just in the LA show, and that was it.
Yeah.
And then, yeah, the set list didn't really deviate much from that.
But so did you know in advance what songs they were going to play, or did you try and hold out?
The week before the Milwaukee show, I was trying like crazy not to look at Hipsters United or Crestfallen.com or YouTube in general. And I saw a quick review of the Rolling Stone did of the LA show, and I saw a few of the songs. And then I wanted to get a little bit of taste for the Oceania songs, just so I would kind of have already familiarized myself with them before the show. And so then, of course, you see, like, you know, the other videos that are linked to that tour. And so I probably knew 75 to 80% of the set list going into the show, but I didn't actually try to, you know, concentrate on what they were going to play. I wanted it to be a, you know, brand new experience for me. And realistically, I don't think it took anything away from the show itself, you know, once I knew that they were going to play Soma and Siva and Geek USA. I mean, they've been talking they were going to play Geek USA for like 2 months now, so I knew they were playing that for sure.
What about the stuff off Pisces? Was that a surprise, or did you know in advance they were going to be doing
Bedazzled
and Pissant?
Yeah, I knew in advance they were going to play some Pisces, but it surprised me that a quarter of their show was dedicated to Pisces. I thought that caught me off guard a little bit. I'm not going to complain about it. I mean, I think I love Pisces Iscariot, but I'm surprised that there was only one Adore and nothing after Adore until Oceania. I mean, I brought three of my friends from work to that show. One of them is 50 years old, and his favorite band is The Who, but the guy listens to Gish on like a weekly basis. He loves Gish. And I'm like, leading up to the show, I'm like, dude, they're not going to play a lot of old stuff. I burned him a copy of the two Tiergarten EPs, and I'm like, listen to this. You got to know these songs. And come to know they didn't play any of it. I was a little disappointed by that because I thought The Fellowship was just a kick-ass song to open with, you know. And Tom Tom I Love, Song for a Son is great. Freak is great. I was shocked they played nothing off Tiergarten except for Lightning Strikes and Awada.
I was too. I think that I wasn't really all that surprised that they didn't play much off of Adore, Machina,
yeah,
Zeitgeist, just because they've played so much, especially off of like Machina and Machina 2 in the recent tours. But the fact they played nothing off Tiergarten was really surprising, besides the two most recent songs.
Well, and the fact that they kind of sent out a general survey to their fan base saying, hey, give me a song off each album that you'd like to hear, you know, and I thought for sure they'd play at least one song off of each, you know, Pumpkins era. And I mean, I would have loved to have heard, like, Real Love off of Machina 2, you know. Machina 1, I mean, they've kind of explored a lot of the Machina 1 territory. I mean, I could always hear Eye of the Morning or Stand Inside Your Love. Those songs never get old. But I'm just going to play Four Martha because that's probably one of my top five Pumpkin songs.
So do you think they'll vary it up at all now that they're going over to Europe? They have a couple of weeks to make changes to the set.
I would assume so. I mean, it seems like they do a little tweaking, you know, within each break. I think when they toured under Zeitgeist and they went over to Europe, I think they changed the set list up quite a bit. I mean, I remember they played Stellar over in Europe for a while, and I would have loved to have heard that song too. That was one of the songs I did a pretty please on my Twitter account for them to play on this tour. But I can't wait to hear all the Oceania stuff, and I'm kind of glad they didn't play the entire album, just so that it's fresh when you hear it for the first time.
Yeah, I am too. I think that was a wise move.
I would agree. I mean, initially, I wasn't in the orchestra pit. I opted for the second row of the seats at the Milwaukee show. And when they started off with Quasar and Panopticon, I mean, it was so loud. Like, initially it was so loud that I at first thought they were playing something off of Gish. When they started in with Quasar, you know, I couldn't really figure it out. And it was really hard to try to decode that song when you hear it initially in a live setting, especially if it's the first thing they open with. But now on the bootleg that I've got, it sounds better and better every time I listen to it. I've got
it's
high
hopes.
It's
funny because I just talked to somebody yesterday who went to the Philadelphia show, and he said the exact same thing, that the first two songs were just like kind of a loud wash.
Yeah, that's exactly it. And then you get into the Starlet chords, and everyone's like, okay, now I know where I am, you know? And I didn't even think – I thought that Quasar and Panopticon were just one song. because they don't really ever stop playing throughout.
Right.
And so I'm like, what is this 8-9 minute song? At first I thought it might be Oceania, you know, but so I knew that was the one epic coming off of the new record.
So you said you did buy the USB bootleg.
No, I went up to the guy who was selling them, and I'm like, well, what's the difference between just buying a download of the show on the USB? And he wasn't very helpful at all. Hmm. He's like, oh, there's a little extra stuff. I'm like, well, what is it? And he's like, I don't know. And so I'm just like, well, just give me the live show then.
So you bought the download.
I bought the download, but not the USB, yeah.
Yeah, from what I've heard, he was kind of accurate in, I don't know, it's just some
little
stuff. Yeah, it's been hard to even get details about what that other stuff is. It's apparently been some pictures and a couple videos that they're not on the USB itself. It's the USB has to be plugged into your computer in order to access the website that they're on.
Okay.
And apparently as of a couple days ago at least, there wasn't much out there. So
well, I mean, I figured I'd see it eventually anyways, you know.
Yeah.
I needed to save $10 for beer money for the show.
Did you buy any of the other merchandise that was there?
I did not. No, I've got enough tour t-shirts, and being 32 years old, I don't think I can go around wearing band tour concert t-shirts anymore. It's kind of like the dude who wears the football jersey at the games, you know. It's like, that's just a sign that you've never played.
Yeah.
I don't know. No, I've got plenty of Pumpkins tour shirts and Zwan tour shirts and plenty of paraphernalia. I didn't need another tour t-shirt.
And you said you did not go to the pre-show meetup beforehand?
No, it was... Long story short, it was actually my daughter's birthday that day, so my wife and I were already in kind of a domestic dispute that I was leaving at like 6 o'clock to drive to Milwaukee to go to the show on my daughter's 6th birthday. So, it's, you know, leaving at 3 or 3:30, I had to make a concession somewhere, and after hearing about what the meetups prior to that had been like, I didn't really think I was missing that much. I mean, if the band would have been there, I'd have been the most furious guy in the face of this planet that I missed that, but it didn't seem like I missed much, just more of like an open-ended discussion of what you wanted to see the record club be in the future.
Yeah, and it sounds like the ones afterwards, like especially the Philadelphia one, the band was there. Like,
yeah.
When I talked to the guy who was at the Philly show, he was saying how Billy was there for like 40 minutes talking to everybody.
Did you see the video of that?
No.
I saw the video for the first time today. I think there was a link on Hipsters United, and it's some fan guy who literally shot the entire 40-minute conversation.
I'm surprised they allowed that.
Really?
Yeah. Well, I mean, that seems like the kind of... Billy, of course, is, you know, he's come outside after shows, and, you know, like Monty or other people have videoed it, and he's never really cared about that. But
yeah.
I'm just kind of surprised at something like this that he would want that to be.
Well, you should watch that video because the angle that it's shot, it's almost like this lens is like at this guy's waist. You know, so I'm sure he was hiding it, to tell you the truth. But it's pretty awesome stuff. I mean, he really breaks down the process that he had to go through to get the contractual rights to all his old music. And what EMI was making them do, and what they originally proposed, it's pretty far out there, and it's really good insight as to what he went through, like just to get the rights to re-release everything that he wanted.
Yeah, I'll have to check that out.
Absolutely, yeah, that's what I did over my lunch hour today. Boning up for the interview.
So, is there anything else about the show that you wanted to talk about, or anything else that struck your mind?
About the show in general, well, his dad was at that show, and right before, I don't know if you, were you at the Milwaukee show by any chance?
No, I actually didn't go to any of the shows in this tour. They did not come close enough to Columbus for me this time.
Oh, got it. Okay. Yeah, so I was down in the first level, and then in a lot of the older theaters that they were playing on, you know, there's generally like the balcony box seating for all like, you know, special friends, VIP people. And I looked up probably, I don't know, a quarter of the way into the show, and I see this old guy with a baseball hat on, just like, you know, legs crossed, just chilling out watching this show. And I kind of did a double take, and I'm like, is that his dad? And the more I got to looking at it and thinking, well, I mean, it's Milwaukee, you know, I'm like, that's totally his dad. And then I saw him stand up at one point, and he just has these humongous hands, just like Billy. Totally his dad. And so the guy next to me, he actually he saw what I was looking at. He's like, "Who's that old guy?" I'm like, "I guarantee that's Corbin's dad." And so then right during the encore, right when they were starting Bullet, he stopped and he's like, "By the way, that's my dad up there. Daddy, say hi." And so like his dad takes a bow and he's like, "He's the original rat in the cage." that was pretty entertaining. that was the same night as game four of the National League Championship Series. And so like half the people in the show are monitoring the Brewer game on their iPhones. And so midway through the show, we all got notification the Brewers won. And I don't know if you're a big baseball fan, but I am. And this was like
the first
Brewers got this far in like 30 years. So it's a big deal in Milwaukee. And so right after they finished, was it a Wada? I started this chant, "Let's go Brew Crew." And everybody in the venue starts chanting, "Let's go Brew Crew," right in between Owada and "My Love is Winter." And I tried to listen to it back on the soundboard mix, but you couldn't hear anything. But the reviewer of the show, he actually made mention of that in the review. And I don't know if I told you this or not, but the review, the Journal Sentinel, they hired some freelance guy to actually cover the show for him. And it was a complete hack job. Like, he literally let off his the title of the review was "Smashing Pumpkins Skimp on the Hits." Yeah, and I'm like, I couldn't believe it. And he literally, he didn't talk anything at all really about the context of the show. It was just about how they didn't play Today or 1979 or Tonight. He barely mentioned any of the other band members. And he didn't mention anything about, you know, Tiergarten or Oceania or any of that stuff. And he basically said the loudest cheers went up when they could sing along to Bullet with Butterfly Wings. And I'm like, is this the same show that I was at? You know, like, I totally was like, this, there's no way this guy was at the show. Like, I think he knew somebody who went to the show who was a casual fan. And then he just, you know, gave him the 5-minute description. And then he wrote this review for the Journal Sentinel. And so I emailed this guy, and it was a pretty vindictive rant-type email. And I'm like, look, dude, I've been a fan for X amount of years, you know. And I kind of went into the whole, Corgan's recent beefs about, you know, not being able to please the quote-unquote hardcore fan base and, you know, not playing, you know, God knows what off of Siamese Dream or Melancholy Infinite Sadness. And it's, and I kind of went into how, you know, is an artist really an artist if their audience feels like, you know, deserving of listening to, you know, these radio singles, you know, back in 1995? And I basically said, look, you had to pay $60 for these tickets. Do you really think a casual fan who only wanted to hear Zero would drop $60 15 years after the height of this band's popularity? You know, and so then, I mean, it was a rant. I can send it to you if you want, but it was a pretty articulate rant, I thought. And so that same night, the general writer sends me an email. Hey, thanks for the impassioned email. I appreciate your insight. Would you mind if I put this on the Journal Sentinel blog? You know, I totally thought he was going to, like, sort of pick a fight with me, you know. But he's like, oh, you know, message received, you know. Well spoken, thank you. So, I don't know. And then I referenced Greg Kot's review from the Chicago night. And I'm like, this is what a real review should look like, you know, douchebag.
Fought the good fight. I'm sure Billy appreciates it.
Absolutely, yeah. Yeah, so but no, I mean, it's awesome being a Pumpkins fan right now in 2011, I think. I mean, with the reissues coming and having all the rights. And one of the things that he did say in that 40-minute video that I watched today is, per the EMI contract requirement, they have to reissue Pisces next year. They've got to reissue the Peel Sessions. They've got to reissue Melancholy, Aeroplane Flies High, and Adore, all in 2012.
They have to reissue the Peel Sessions? Was that a big seller for them?
I know, I was shocked when you said that, but it was either the Peel Sessions or the pre-Gish Sessions. And isn't that the Peel Sessions?
Peel Sessions was after Gish.
Oh, it's some pre-Gish session then.
Oh, I would love if they released pre-Gish stuff. I don't know why a record label would want them to do that.
Well, that's exactly it. And it's almost like, well, initially he said that, EMI said, we only are interested in Siamese Dream and Melancholy reissues with a live show from the Melancholy tour. And now he basically said, in order to fulfill this contract so he can get his own rights, he's got to do all of this. So, and I don't know if that was some kind of a bargaining, you know, ploy that he incorporated with EMI, but it's like, holy shit. So you're doing that, and you're touring on a new record, you're releasing a record, and you're writing a book. You know, it's an awesome time to be a Pumpkins fan.
Yeah. It must be EMI knows that Smiley is going to be a big hit. It Jesus didn't make it the baby. First time around.
Yeah, exactly. Honestly, I've never heard any of that stuff.
You'll like, be in for a treat. It's interesting. The pre-Gish era is definitely it's a different Pumpkins listening experience than most of their released stuff. So you should definitely check it out.
Looking forward to it.
Well, thanks a lot for coming on the podcast.
Oh, you betcha. Yeah, this is a great time. My wife always kind of rolls her eyes when I start talking about the Pumpkins these days, so glad I could connect with someone who's just as big of a Pumpkins geek as me.
Yep, very cool.
And go Bucky.
Well, thanks for joining me this evening. Our closing song is Obscured from Washington, D.C. on October 17th, 2011. Good night, everybody.
Thank you.
The Hipsters United podcast is not affiliated with or endorsed by the Smashing Pumpkins, Virgin Records, or Warner Brothers Reprise Records. All opinions offered by panelists or guests of the Hipsters United podcast are their own and do not represent the opinions of the Smashing Pumpkins. All audio during the show is licensed for nonprofit use per the terms and conditions on the Live Music Archive at archive.org. Intro music is from the Machina 2 album released for free download on the internet by the Smashing Pumpkins in September of 2000.